Hey, wrestling friends. Welcome to episode 5 of Suplexes and Microphones. I'm Nate Pritchard. This is Joseph Brown. Today we have Anthony Henry with us, and we're going to talk about him and get to know him a little better, ask some questions that hopefully you, the fans, would want to ask him if you had a chance to talk to him. Also, we'll have a little surprise later on, so more on that later.
That's right. Well, Anthony, we're glad to have you here. I was talking to you just a few minutes ago. We weren't sure if we could get you in here or not, because you're a little bit introverted, but yeah. that's perfectly cool. But the other reason that Nate and I wanted to get you here as soon as we could, and obviously we're only 4 guests in, although this is episode 5, Nate and I were talking about when we first kicked this thing off this year, who do you want to get in here? And Nate says, well, we need to get Henry in. I said, why do you want Henry? He says, well, he could be gone soon, and we won't be able to interview him. So obviously that's a compliment to you. If you look behind us here, he is the current PWX World Heavyweight Champion. The current XWA Heavyweight Champion. So he's got titles. He's nationally recognized. He is a huge talent on the rise, continuing to get bookings all over the country. We were just talking about this weekend. We won't have this video out by that time, but you got Maryland.
Mm-hmm.
And where else?
Virginia, mm-hmm. which that's Nova Pro. Okay. Maryland is MCW, which is a pretty big deal.
Right.
And then Tier 1 in Brooklyn. New York. So.
All right. So
second time there. So
nice.
Not Tier 1, but second time in Brooklyn. It's fancy.
That's awesome. So again, a nationally recognized talent. And first thing I want to talk about is Nate and I have actually seen you in 4 different promotions at this point.
Okay.
And one of our favorites and our first PWX show was the X16 tournament.
Okay.
The last one.
Yes.
This is the winner of the X16 tournament. And you beat some of the biggest names. It's like a who's who of independence. Yeah. Martin Stone, Trevor Lee, Ethan Case, and Zack Sabre Jr.
Yes. Wow.
One of the things I wanted to talk to you about in regards to that tournament is how that led to your current being the champion. If people know how PWX mm-hmm. works, then they do. But if they don't, I'd like you to explain that and kind of what that's meant to you. PWX is a well-established brand. So talk a little bit about that for us.
Yeah, I mean, PWX, it's crazy my story with PWX because back in, 2012, that was just my goal, was just to wrestle there.
Okay.
You know, mm-hmm. I was mainly doing things in Georgia and a little bit in South Carolina and stuff. And PWX was kind of just that place. It wasn't nowhere as big as it is now. So it's grown a lot, mm-hmm. but it was still the place in terms of the Southeast. So I got there and I did my thing. Years went by. And then, we started off, this big push towards making me, the guy there. So that kind of, we did the dreams, almost like a dream series where I wrestled everybody, Tommaso Ciampa 3 times, Sammy Callahan, all these guys. And that led to X16, which is kind of always X16 is kind of whoever wins X16, they get their title shot, whenever they want it,
right.
That type of thing. So that was kind of, I guess, the realization that it was going to happen, finally being put in the X16, knowing, winning the X16.
Right.
I knew then, I was finally going to get that main event title match. And then, of course, that happened. And so X16 and then also the subsequent, title match, probably the two of the biggest moments in my career. And, not even from a standpoint of being the two biggest things I've done, because that's arguable at this point, I think, with some of the stuff I've done. But for me personally, PWX was kind of my home promotion, the first promotion that this went out on a limb for me,
okay.
Put me out there and went out of their way to do so. And so and then of course the roster is there, and amongst all the guys that are there, for them to say, hey, you're going to be the guy,
sure.
who we run with, big moments for me, for sure.
Definitely. And like I said, Nate and I were there when you won. And at the time, you, and you don't get on the microphone a lot, you got on the microphone and you said, this is the biggest moment
right.
of my career.
Right.
Which led to Rise of a Champion, PWX show a few months later. You beat Jake Manning for the title.
Mm-hmm.
Nate and I were there for that. And obviously, we were cheering for you. There's a hometown guy for us. We're in Augusta. We're actually at Suplex's and headquarters, Suplex's and Microphone's headquarters, also known as Nate's house.
Yeah.
So we really appreciate Anthony coming here and sitting down with us.
Hey, they got me a monster. I'm good.
Yeah, we actually got you three monsters,
you did,
technically.
So
I also want to keep one for myself. You should.
Sorry.
it's our sponsor.
Since Joe mentioned it.
You know.
So currently, you're in what I like to call a friendly feud with Ethan Case and PWX.
Right.
And not to, you know, Ethan was our first guest and one of our favorite people.
Mm-hmm.
You've beaten Ethan before mm-hmm. in the tournament we were just talking about.
Right.
But this most recent, What Lies Beneath, controversial finish. Personally, I went back and watched your X16 final match, which was great. And then Nate and I were there for What Lies Beneath. I think the match at What Lies Beneath was twice as good.
Definitely.
And again, the first match was great. So that's definitely saying something that you guys, you don't rest on your laurels. You're always improving.
Great chemistry, too, between the two.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Let's talk a little bit. I want to hear from you about this current friendly feud with Ethan.
Ethan is a guy who I've known for a really long time. And have been in the same circles as him for even longer. I don't know that he's from Augusta, but he's from the CSRA, at least, I believe, or he's been here for a long time.
Right.
So, I mean, we've gone around in the same circles and been around the same people and et cetera. So, I've wrestled Ethan Case several times, actually, twice in Flatline for Flatline Pro.
Mm-hmm.
We did it way back in the day at APW, which is in Royston, not the APW Chester.
Okay.
So we wrestled there, and then obviously we had the match at X16, and then the most recent match, the controversial match. And I mean, I don't have anything bad to say about Ethan. I mean, I would say that we're friends.
Right.
I like the guy. He's very talented.
Yeah.
Very charismatic. I call him. I call him the Zach Morris of pro wrestling. This
okay.
is what I think of when I think of Ethan Case, which is a compliment in itself because you know back in the day, like Zach Morris was like my idol. So,
sure.
So you know, I think actually my first haircut was. Because I had long hair when I was a kid, so
yeah.
My first haircut was like, I want to get my haircut like Zach Morris.
So you said, do the Saved by the Bell.
For right.
Okay.
Which is basically a bowl cut or whatever. but I'm the champion. So, I mean,
yes.
Friends or not, I'm not going to, let that get in the way, I guess. I'm not going to lay down for him.
Right.
We have, you're right, we have great chemistry together in the ring. We put on good matches together, for sure. And I think the one that's coming up in July,
yes.
the 2 out of 3 falls, I think that's, you know, that's going to be the best of the best. So he and I are both guys that we, like you said, we never rest on our laurels because we're always looking to improve upon ourselves and
mm-hmm.
improve upon our last performance. So 2 out of 3 falls is going to be crazy. It's going to be insane. And I can't think of a better guy to be in there with to do that.
I agree.
Now, this is a question. This wasn't on our script. I'm just freestyling for a second.
Sure.
But while we're talking about PWX and your feud with Ethan
mm-hmm.
And What Lies Beneath, some of the fan base was kind of upset there wasn't a definitive answer, definitive win,
all right.
a victory at that match. Me personally, I'm kind of from the old school, and I prefer a slow build, a false finish, a dusty finish, if you will, kind
mm-hmm.
of what happened then.
Yeah.
Controversial ending, and then the building up to another match. I love it, you know, but, you know, some of the younger generation, they're more into instant gratification. You
yes.
know, Star Wars movie just came out. I want to watch the next one next week. I
yes.
want it to come out right away,
yes.
kind of thing.
Right.
You know, wanting it now. Binge watching on Netflix, seasons after seasons, you know. Want now. So,
right.
kind of, what's your thought about how, if you're able to say anything, what's kind of your thought between?
Yeah, my thoughts are exactly the same as yours, is that the current state of wrestling, you know, is fans think that anything that is not a clean win in their eyes is a BS finish, which, you know, I think the fans get too involved in their own opinions and their own self, and they assume that they know more than they do, and they analyze every little thing, and it's like, please, like if you're in a movie theater, I hate these people too, though. I heard them after I watched Wonder Woman the other day, which is a story on itself, but...
I saw that.
Yeah, but after watching Wonder Woman, like, that movie was great. If you haven't seen it, go see it, but it was a great, especially for a superhero movie, one of the best, and we walk outside after the movie, or out in, still in the theater, and everybody's going to the bathroom and stuff, and I hear somebody like analyzing this one little thing in the movie, like, oh, they stopped fighting in the middle and just to do this and talk, and like, why would you do that? It's like, man, shut up. Just enjoy it. So for wrestling fans, I feel it's the same way. You know, sometimes they just need to sit back and like enjoy it. Just be a fan. Mm-hmm. But to some degree, I would say that, you know, the BS finish or the people being upset is kind of what we, you know, obviously what the idea was. Mm-hmm. So in that sense, I think it worked, and the same people who you know, are talking about, you know, never coming to PWX again and etc., those would be the first people that will probably buy their ticket and will be there, and that's the entire point. That's what wrestling is like, if Ethan Case and Anthony Henry have a match, it's a main event match. And granted, we got to remember that this particular show was kind of the first show where we didn't bring in any like big names, really. Mm-hmm. There was no Michael Elgin, there was no Sami Callihan, there was etc., and go on and on, but it was just us, and the main event was Ethan Case versus Anthony Henry, and let's see what happens. I think that was a main event match.
Definitely.
The story was there, the build was there, and when we got in the ring together, I think it felt like a main event match, and I think we gave them a main event ending. Why should we give it all to you at once?
Mm-hmm.
Like, sit back and, you know, let it unfold and see what happens, and, you know, you might like it.
Yeah.
Maybe, possibly, you might hate it, but just sit back and watch and let it happen.
Yeah, and you know, Nate and I drove almost 3 hours to go up there, and correct me if I'm wrong, on the way back, did either one of us at any point go, God, that ending, that was terrible?
No.
I don't remember having that discussion. I remember us saying, man, it was a great match, great match. You know?
I thought it was unique.
Yeah.
I thought it was different. So, I mean... And especially if you watch MMA at all, like, that kind of stuff happens all the time.
Right.
It's not really that much of a BS deal. I mean, it was supposed to spark interest and kind of allude to another match happening, but, you know, in and of itself, the finish is something that happens in MMA fights all the time. Guys
right.
go out and that's it, and you know, the old three-hand raise the thing, like, nobody does that. Nobody believes that anymore anyway, so...
Mm-hmm.
Why even do that?
Right.
I think actually in WWE recently, they did the same thing with like Samoa Joe or somebody, where it was just had him, rear naked choke, and there was no three hands raised.
Mm-hmm.
It was just, oh,
he's out.
Mm-hmm. And I think that's a cool idea. I think it's a cool concept that should be in pro wrestling in general. So,
like, so with MMA, they don't do that in MMA, a legit fight. There's no
right.
three damage spot.
Because why would, if you're getting choked, I mean, if you've done any kind of grappling, if you've ever been choked before in your life,
mm-hmm.
a real choke, like, it depends on how tight it is, but if it's a good choke, I mean, you maybe have 5 seconds.
That's what
you know what I mean? Maybe. And then you're already out.
Right.
Yeah.
Like, you know? So, I don't know. Wrestling, that's the other thing about wrestling fans, is like, most of them haven't been in a real fight in their life. And, like, there's way dumber things that we do, like whip each other off the rope, which you would never do.
Right.
Like, you and I get in a fight, I'm not going to, like, try to whip you into your wall.
Right.
Yeah. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like,
yeah.
Well, we personally enjoyed it. We liked the ending, and, like, the fantasy booker and me, I'll turn to Joe during the match, remember this, like, okay, either A's going to happen, blah, 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 or B's going to happen, blah, blah, blah. So I was like, I kind of try to call what's going to happen. So
it's,
I loved it.
It
yeah.
sparked interest, so,
yeah,
and that's
yeah.
the whole idea.
And they got people talking about it, too.
Right. Right.
You know, whether positive or negative, they're talking about
that's
it.
That's the point.
So.
And if they come back and we do a bigger draw in the rematch,
mm-hmm.
that's the entire point of wrestling.
Mm-hmm.
We got more butts in seats now.
Mm-hmm.
And they're here to see this, and they're invested in this story because they saw Ethan get screwed last time, so let's see if he gets, you know, what his due is,
yeah.
his just due, and let's see if he can pull it out. Especially like after coming back from injury and the whole thing, like
mm-hmm.
he's the underdog in a sense, and he's
big
the guy.
Story there.
Yeah.
Well, since we're talking about mixed martial arts, it was at Road to Rise of a Champion. I took my family to their first PWX event. You fought Jason Cade.
Mm.
I want to talk about that match in a minute, but if you recall, you actually got your mouth busted open
mm-hmm.
pretty good. If you recall, I came up to you either at intermission or after the show, I don't remember which, and I said, dude, your kicks are phenomenal.
Yeah.
And we started talking about martial arts, and come to find out, you trained at the same school I did, just different periods of time.
Mm.
I was only there a year, year and a half. I think you were there a little longer, but again, completely missed each other at that gym. But if anybody follows Anthony on social media, he posted a GIF this week that I had sent to him of him from the X16 tournament kicking Trevor Lee. And, you know, we're talking about suspension of disbelief with the,
right.
the three-hand raise and,
mm-hmm.
and bringing in realistic elements. If you watch that GIF, and the reason I sent that, because I had three or four that I could have sent, if you watch that GIF on that spinning back kick, you turn that head around first to find that target before that leg comes around.
Mm-hmm.
Just technique, just off the chain. And then with that rear leg roundhouse, you're spinning on the ball of that foot, of the lead foot, to get up and over. There's guys that are known for kicks in wrestling that don't do those things.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But you, on the other hand, I'm over there as a martial artist, and I'm like, oh, that makes me like, this is the real deal.
Yeah.
It adds realism to someone who's, you know, taking karate class, taking a kickboxing class, done MMA or something like that. So for me, there was just a whole another level of appreciativeness for your skills.
Okay.
And I told you that then.
Yeah.
Talk a little bit about your MMA background, maybe some of the arts that you have studied, dabbled in, or any of that. I've heard some of your previous interviews
mm-hmm.
you talk about a little bit, but if you don't mind, tell our fans
sure.
as well.
Yeah, no worries. So there's actually a period of time, 2004, maybe early 2005, where wrestling just wasn't doing it for me. At the time, there were just some things in the way, myself partially in the way. I used to be a very angry individual, which what you see now is, when we talk about me being introverted, you see a very much so tamed version of what I was before. And so, like, I was partially my fault for the things in wrestling just not going my way. But needless to say, I quit for a while. Some things happened and I quit, and MMA and UFC was always something that was there for me. It's always something I always followed, even like going back to, like, you know, UFC 1. Like, I was always into it. I thought Ken Shamrock was awesome back in the day because he wore like wrestling gear.
Yeah.
He really had the trunks and like, so yeah, like, it was always something I wanted to do. So I got into a school and the Grupples had just opened up. Well, actually, yeah, I think maybe that was the first school I went to. Technically, I went to kickboxing school for a while in 2004 while I was still wrestling.
Okay.
American Kickboxing Academy, which actually was like up here somewhere
mm-hmm.
before. But yeah, after that, I ended up at Grubles, and
right.
they were still in like kind of the early stages. But yeah, I stayed there for, I don't know, 3 or 4 years, something like that. Maybe even longer. Because I was still, like, I did that, and I was fighting. I did some amateur fights in Augusta. I did these crazy three-way pro fights.
I've seen a couple of those. Not yours, but... Yeah,
yeah. In Virginia, which was called Sando, which the place is it's gone. It's no longer there. But I did those, and then when I got back into wrestling, which is, like, 2008-ish, Sugar Dunkerton, which you guys know... He was at the last PWX show, or the one before it. Were you guys there?
I missed that.
We did miss that.
Well, he's a guy in Augusta. He's also a pro wrestler. He gets around a lot, too. But he was kind of the reason why I came back, because I was just kind of talking to him, and I rode along with him to a show. And
yeah.
I brought my, I had these little, like, tap-out, these gray tap-out shorts, little tights. And I wore those, and they put me on the show. And then So I never stopped going. Like from there on in, it was, you know, week after week, and kind of went from there. But while I was training, I mean, it was an MMA school, so I did everything. It was kickboxing. We had Thai classes. We had just amateur wrestling classes. And then the jiu-jitsu stuff, which obviously probably the same coach that you had, if you did any of that, which was Chris Elms.
Yeah, I had Chris for a little while.
Yeah, Chris Elms is probably probably the baddest man in Augusta.
He's not here anymore, though.
He's not?
No, he's moved.
He moved. Well, he was.
Yeah.
I don't care how big the guy was, I would put him against him.
And the cool thing, and I'll say this about Chris, I've studied under a lot of different instructors because I've jumped around from gym to gym.
Mm-hmm.
As far as breaking a technique down and teaching it, I don't know if there's anybody better.
Yeah.
And that's no disrespect to any other teacher.
Right.
There's a lot of good ones, but Chris could really break it down. So.
Honestly, I did the kickboxing and stuff, but I was definitely more of a jits guy,
okay.
Honestly. I won all my fights by submission, so I was definitely more of a jits guy, probably about a purple belt level. I beat, like, my first fight, I fought a purple belt. He was actually an instructor in Statesboro, apparently.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't tell me that till after the fight, because I thought I'd get nervous.
Yeah.
But I triangled him,
nice.
and actually after the fight, he came to the dressing room, shook my hand and everything. He was like, "Where'd you get your jits at?" So I just pointed to Chris Elms, but I never did a gi, so I never technically got a belt, because most places don't give you a belt if you don't do gi.
You have to
do gi, unless it's like Eddie Bravo stuff, which is all no gi. But I would say maybe late stage blue belt, early purple belt was my level when I stopped. So I was pretty good. I was all right for a white boy.
It's good. Since we're talking about UFC, who are your favorite UFC fighters?
You know, I don't know that I necessarily like get into favorites on that. Like,
what do you like to watch then?
I like Conor a lot.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Maybe it's the promos. Maybe
he gooder.
Yeah, man. It's like I even thought about like bringing in an element of that into my stuff. It's like. Being like a Conor McGregor, if the heel thing ever happens for me, you know, like a PWX and stuff, is bringing that element in. Because either way, whether you love or hate him, people pay to see him.
Yeah.
Because he talks so much. And so I like watching him. There's guys that I do like to watch, but it's mostly guys that like I came up watching. There's a lot of new people now that I have no idea who they are. And so like the last, what was the fights that just happened? It was... I looked up the play-by-play. I always look up the play-by-play on Sheardog if I don't get to watch it.
Mm.
I used to like to watch George St. Pierre.
Yeah.
Diaz brothers.
Yeah.
I like watching them just because they the same reason. They talk a lot of crap. And
even during the fight.
He could be losing the fight.
Yeah,
either one
matter.
Of them could be losing the fight, and they will still be taunting the guy, which
it
is something else I've thought about bringing in.
That'd be good.
Because like, I think that's a cool thing that doesn't happen in wrestling. It's like... You're getting hit, but it's like, you know, you're still like taunting him and calling him whatever, and
mm-hmm.
I don't know.
I like that. Kevin Owens has some of that.
Yeah.
I do like that.
He'd be the guy that's closest to doing
put
that.
More on the offense.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What I wanted to talk about from the lead of the MMA side of things is, I think, for me at least, when I watch you wrestle, you're probably the most well-rounded guy. And the reason I say that, if you can grapple with Zack Sabre, kick with Trevor Lee, and then do all the all-around stuff with Ethan, you know, you've got most of the elements covered. You pull off some power moves every now and then, too.
Yeah.
It's not strictly... You're a smaller guy. You're a light and lean guy, so a lot of people think, oh, he's going top rope. You rarely go top rope.
Yeah.
You know, and because you have all these other elements, and so that when I watch you, I definitely think, okay, he can go to this, he can do that, you know. It's never as one guy's on a trick pony type.
Yeah,
thing,
yeah.
You know, so again, as a fan, my perspective, I really appreciate the fact that you can bring in so many different elements. You watch some other guys, and it's like, he's about to do this. And
yeah.
He can only do that and other
well,
things.
I mean, for me, part of it is that's the idea, is just being that well-rounded guy. Like, you have guys like, you know, especially back in the day, Jericho and, you know, Benoit. the guy who shall not be named. So.
I heard you're a Benoit fan.
I am.
I don't believe in racist history, so yeah, feel free.
There's other guys, Eddie Guerrero.
Right.
Guys who could do kind of everything. So that was always what I wanted to be when I was, like, you know, and when I started wrestling, like, that's the reason why my name is Anthony Henry, because it is my name. Mm-hmm. And when I was coming up as a fan in indie wrestling, and really, like, before I started getting into training and stuff, like, that's what I wanted to do. I just wanted to be a wrestler. Mm-hmm. I didn't care about the other part of it. I didn't want to... Jesus Christ. Something happened. I don't know what.
Crashing noise.
That was a noise.
The roof just fell in. Which is a microphone.
Do an insurance claim.
We'll work it out.
But that Ethan Case part of it, if you will, that entertainment part, like, I wasn't really interested in that at all then. You know, I just wanted to be like Dean Malenko or Eddie Guerrero and those guys. Like, so yeah, I appreciate that you noticed those things. And yeah, you're right. I don't go up that often. I could flip if I want. Like, I could you know, stand right here and do a back tuck and land on my feet. But there's gonna be guys who do it way better than me. And I'm not gonna be Ricochet. I'm not gonna be, you know, whoever. So I'd rather be the guy who can just do a little bit of everything.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I think that's my thing. That's what I do. I think I can have a match with anybody, and I can adapt to them. So.
Yeah. Well, we'll finish with a backflip for the show, but
since
we're talking about that, you're talking about you can go with just about anybody because of your skill set. I want to tell you my two favorite in-person Anthony Henry matches.
Okay.
Now, again, I've talked to some people this week, prep work, and Caleb Kitchens must have sent me a dozen videos of, you got to watch this Henry match, and watch this, and he does more of this and this. And so, thanks, Caleb. You gave me a lot of homework. But obviously, he speaks very highly of you, and he knows your skill set as well. But for me, Palmetto Championship Wrestling against Rob Killjoy, 30-minute time limit draw, that was an incredible match. And again, we didn't have a true finish on that. And guess what? It was fine because the match was so good. Absolutely.
No,
match is probably, if we went to two or three shows, it'd be the match of the night. So that was one of my favorites. I'd like for you to talk a little bit about working with Rob, but the other one I want you to talk about is the match where you got your mouth busted open a little bit. Road to Rise of a Champion, Jason Cade, who, that guy, you know, going in, we didn't know who he was. He fought Drake the first night at X16. I think that was the first time we saw him. And we really liked him because he actually gave you the finger during the match.
Right.
But anyway.
I like the interaction. So,
yeah, we're all about the interaction with wrestlers. So if you don't mind, talk about working with Rob in that match or any match, because you've wrestled him many times.
Yep.
And then also the Jason Cade, because the stuff he did with the basketball goal, you guys, that was creative. It was something I hadn't seen. So go ahead with that.
So me and Rob, obviously we know each other very well. Again, we were in a group that has been unofficially named the Work Horsemen, which is basically just all of us that kind of, we all like each other. We all, you know, consider each other at least acquaintances / friends, whatever.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And we're always all over the place. So, you know, on any given weekend, we're maybe on two opposite sides of the country, you know, but we're doing our thing, and it's all about a shared love and passion for this business. And so that's kind of why we've put this group together. Who knows, we may have some merchandise at some point. So Rob, actually it's funny, let's go back. So when I was at PWX, before Rob ever came in, Rob would come to the show sometimes and just be a fan and watch. I remember actually one time Rob came up to me after a show, and he was like, "Hey man," I had no idea who he was. And I didn't necessarily cold shoulder him, but it was like, he was like, "Yeah, man, I want to work you. You know, I think we do really good stuff together." I'm like, "Yeah, cool, man." I have no idea who this guy is.
Was he missing a tooth then, or did he have the?
Yeah, he was missing the tooth,
okay.
And he still had short hair and everything, but so he didn't have the long hair. But yeah, I didn't know who he was, so I was just kind of like, "Who the hell is this guy?" Mm-hmm. And then like I heard some bad things about him from some other wrestlers, that he wasn't that good and stuff. So I had no idea what to think at all. I'm trying to think. I think our first match was actually still before he came officially to PWX. We did some stuff for a promotion called Legacy,
mm-hmm.
which was in North Carolina. So we did that. It was okay. It was decent. He was a little nervous, which was weird because now we're totally cool. But he was nervous at that point. Like, I remember us talking about the match and what we wanted to do, and he had no idea. He was just like,
"Really?
I don't know. I usually have all this stuff in my head, but I don't know." And I'm like, "Oh, okay." But it was still decent. And then, you know, he found his way in the PWX finally. And, you know, they eventually put together the Ugly Duglings, which is like, just like, they just did that by, you know, it was the weirdest, just, thing. They just kind of put it together.
Like a random idea.
Yeah, it was, and then, like, it became a thing, obviously. So, and then from there, we've had matches at APW Chess, which actually were really good. Like, we had, like, a two-show kind of story deal we did, a little angle where, like, I wrestled him one time, and there was some kind of screwy finish, and then the second time, I won the belt, but then the ref was down, so, like, they did the whole thing, and then he pinned me, like, off a roll-up. And it was awesome. Fans were crazy for that. And then, finally, the match at PCW.
Yeah.
That match, 30 minutes, we had so much more stuff we were going to do.
Oh, yeah?
And then, like, they're, like, 28 minutes or whatever. We're like, oh, crap, let's do this.
Yeah.
And it, you know, that match was one of those things. We were just kind of feeling it out there. You know, it was a lot of just going by feel.
Right.
And the fans, I remember we had like three This Is Awesome chants and all this stuff, and I was like, cool.
Oh, yeah.
Like that, because you never know how the fans would react, and I'm used to like smart mark crowds who do a lot of the chanting, but for there I was like, man, this place is, you know, we were in this little high school gym or whatever. Mm-hmm. And I was like, it's probably going to be a real Southern crowd, but it's Rob, so we're going to go out there and do all kinds of stuff, because with Rob, you're never going to not work, which on the same token, probably me too, you know. You're probably not, even if I'm in front of like 20 people, I'm probably going to do more than most people would for 20 people.
That's great.
Yeah.
That's just the way I am, that's the way he is, so it worked out, and yeah, he's a fun guy to work with. And then, so we talk about Jason Cade, which he's also blowing up now. All over the place, if you guys don't know. He's like debuting for PWG coming up.
Nice.
He did a lot of stuff during WrestleMania weekend that kind of got him some exposure.
Good.
So good for him.
Yeah.
I've worked him a couple times also. I did work him WrestleMania weekend, and that was a good one. But the PWX one probably does stand out, maybe specifically because of that spot we did the basketball goal.
Yeah.
And that was kind of one of those things where we were just talking, and then like we were on the floor talking, and like we were talking about what we were going to do, and I don't know, the basketball goal was there, and kind of like, hey, you think I could Eddie Guerrero, that's what I always call it, the Eddie Guerrero, because he used to always, the guy would do it to him, and he'd like either hot shot himself on the rope, or he'd land on the turnbuckle and then jump out or whatever.
Yeah.
I was like, I toss you up there, you think you can hit it? And he was just kind of jumping up there, and I was like, he's like, and if you give me an extra push, I'm sure we can do it. So yeah, we did that spot. People went crazy for that.
Oh yeah.
It was I thought that was a really good match.
Now, did you actually practice that spot before?
No.
Wow.
Not really.
Just kind of eyeballed it.
And yeah. It was one of those things.
He
yeah.
can fly, that's for sure. I don't know if you remember, I wasn't even going to bring this up. The first time we saw you in PCW, we had already, you know where I'm going.
Yes.
We had already seen you at Flatline. We had already seen you, I think, at Viral.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a group of, how many we have, 6-7 guys?
At least, yeah.
That we traveled from Augusta, Columbia. And it was you versus Killjoy versus Drake, which
yeah.
that's a you know marquee matchup anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
When you came out, we held up the newspapers.
I remember.
Do you remember that?
Yes.
And you actually took my cousins and rubbed it in your crotch and threw it in his face and nailed him right in the face. So it was a perfect reaction
yeah.
because we were trying to come up with some stuff. I mean, obviously, we were pulling. He's a big Drake guy.
Yeah.
I'm a big Killjoy guy. So we were pulling for those guys.
Mm.
And we, you know.
Well, Drake was heel.
Drake was still heel, but it didn't matter because they would pull for him
yeah,
anyway. but we were basically calling you the enemy that night. You
yeah.
know? And you came out and you did that. And I was like, oh, this is great. You know. But I just didn't know if you would remember that or not.
Sure, yeah.
That was a fun night.
Heel stuff is like. That's the funnest stuff.
That's what everyone we've interviewed has said.
It is. Because, like, as a babyface, you run into the issue of, like, how long are people going to like you? And especially if it's a new place, it's like, how do I make these people like me?
Mm.
Because they might, it just depends on the crowd. And you don't know
sure.
what they're going to like or what they want. They might say, oh, you're a pretty boy, so you're over. If there's a bunch of girls in the crowd,
mm-hmm.
it could be the opposite. If there's a bunch of guys in the crowd, they'd be like, I hate this guy. He looks like he walked out of a boy band, whatever.
Right, right.
So there's that. And but being a heel, you just, you know, you're a douchebag.
All I gotta do is be mean, right?
Yes. I mean, it's...
Yeah.
It's not a difficult thing to do, and it could be a lot of fun, depending on how good you are at it, you know, riling up the crowd. And
we actually wondered if you got, like, took offense to that or what.
No.
You
know,
we had the newspapers up.
Yeah, we had, especially when he walked out, when his entrance music hit, he walks out, we had the newspapers up as if we have no care about who this is.
Leg crossed.
And he stops, and I could eyeball him just over top of the paper, and he stops, looks to his right, and just snatches that paper out of my cousin's hand, and just, it was awesome.
I did,
it was great.
We did West Virginia Championship Wrestling and last weekend, and wrestle Facade, and the little kid, well, Facade comes out with, like, these poster board deals, like, with his stuff spray painted all over, and he gives them out to the fans, and I felt bad about doing it, because it was a little boy, and I was just thinking about, like, how my daughter feels, somebody ripped it out of her hands, but I was like, it's wrestling, I'm a heel. So I just did Jericho, and I pulled it out and ripped it up. Apparently, he didn't care anyway. Apparently, after he was done, he picked up another piece and started ripping it up himself. So, whatever. But I got so booed. People just started booing me for that. Everybody was booing me for that. So it's just those simple, those small things. And I feel like, for me, maybe more so than other people, I just have that look about me where, like, you're just like, I just don't like this guy.
You know?
Like,
I was actually going to bring up, a lot of times I'll see you kind of give this I'm better than you smirk during the match, sometimes to fans, sometimes to the opponent, but I think the more you do that, the more over as a heel you are, because I definitely see this. I mean, when you, especially if you hit a big move and it's like, this guy didn't even belong in the ring with me, you give this little smirk and it's a beautiful heel face.
Funny thing
it's
is,
perfect.
It's natural. Like, that's just something I do.
Well, see, there it is.
Anyway,
it's
so it's
heel,
like,
because he's rather than anybody else, you know. So.
Oh yeah, like, which is funny, but like that is probably like the initial thing that people think when they first meet me is that.
Right.
Especially because I don't talk to a lot of people, just because I don't like a lot of people. I'm being honest. Most people just are not good human beings. And I'm straight edge, like I don't drink, I don't party, like I don't do a lot of things that even wrestlers are known to do. So I don't have a lot in common with a lot of the population. So I don't know, it's always been my thing, and I'm way, way better about it than I used to be. Like, I think Amber, and I've been with her for 5 years now, did a lot just because of her personality and helping me be more open. Because I was probably 10 times worse, just, you know, 5 years ago. So imagine that.
Yeah. Well, you know, you're talking about the straight edge, and I didn't know that about you. There's a couple other guys, Tracer X being one of them. I don't do the label thing, but I've never drank alcohol or anything, so I've kind of got that in common with you. But since we're talking kind of in that format, I said earlier you're one of the leanest guys. Tell us a little about your diet and exercise program. Something, you don't have to break it all down, but kind of give me a couple guidelines that you follow, that some of the people that, hey, I want to have the Anthony Henry body, you know?
Well, that's funny, is because, like, that could be a whole other podcast on itself, because I do have a lot of background in these things. I have a personal trainer, which I know we have some stuff about that later, which we can get into, but I'm a personal trainer, and my degrees are essentially in the field. And beyond that, like, I'm a science nerd, and so when it comes down to breaking down those things, that's very much me.
Okay.
And so I don't share a lot of the same thoughts and beliefs as a lot of people do that are, you know, gym rats.
Okay.
A lot of the information that has been brought forth that gets passed down is kind of stuff that's been passed down from, like, the 70s and 80s and whatever have you, when, you know, bodybuilding was a really big thing. And it's all information that's not necessarily factual. It's not stuff that is backed by any evidence. It's more so just kind of I'm big and I'm on steroids, so you should do what I do, and then they do it, and it gets, you know, passed along. And but there's a lot of information and that's coming out since that time that, you know, is maybe contrary to those things. And it's still, like, if you really think about, like, fitness, it's kind of still, like, in its infancy stages, where, like, it's a lot of science hasn't been brought to it. So I understand it. But yeah, to answer the question, calories are king. So it's calories in versus calories out. There is absolutely no denying that. So calories is the main thing. I do track calories in general. I make sure I have enough protein, which protein is 0.8 to like 1.2 grams per pound of body weight, just to be safe. But that's really lean body mass, so you can really kind of take down less than that. And then fats are generally 20 to 30% of your total calories. So that's that. The rest can you kind of fill in with carbs, and that's what I do. I do a flexible dieting approach.
Okay.
So that just basically means that if I want a cookie, I have it. As long as I meet my fats, proteins, and carbs for the day, which will, at the end of the day, also end up being my total calories for the day, I'm good.
Yeah.
I can have pizza, I can have candy, I can have Monsters. There's no calories in this.
So you watch the numbers on calories for sure.
Yeah.
I actually saw you eat a cupcake, a turnbuckle cupcake, at the last PWX show, and I was like,
Well, I mean, especially on wrestling weekends, I don't necessarily track as much then, because I don't get to eat as much. I'm usually driving, we might stop somewhere, and I'll eat something, but then like hours go by and I haven't eaten anything, so the odds that I'm like gonna go over on my calories and stuff, it's like, it's slim to none,
right.
So if there's cupcakes here, I'm hungry, I'm gonna eat them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's pretty much it as far as the diet goes. Well, as far as working out, now
that's
the difficult part now.
Mm-hmm.
I used to be really into powerlifting, which I still like it a lot, but which is, I'm actually pretty strong for my body weight. At one point I was at like around a 315 bench press, 385 squat. I did a 445 deadlift in competition actually.
Wow.
That's at about a body weight right now. I'm at 165. So I mean, I was really into that, and that's still kind of like the, I guess, the base of what I do. But with all the added bookings that I'm doing now, and the fact that I'm in school, and the fact that I have a daughter that lives with me full time, and all these things, it does actually become difficult to work out as much as I was. Like, I would go in like every single day pretty much.
Mm-hmm.
Now, maybe 3 days, 4 days at the most,
mm-hmm.
and so I have to kind of like, you know, get in all my stuff in a in less days. So it's just a lot of compound stuff. Bench pressing and squatting and deadlifting, and you know, not a whole lot of bodybuilding stuff per se. So I don't do a lot of flies and bicep curls and tricep extensions. I never do abs because I wouldn't say that it's there's no purpose in doing it, but you don't need to. I mean, everybody has abs underneath your fat. It's more about getting the fat off of you than it is about, you know, building them up. So that's pretty much it in a nutshell. I ran a lot, so you can stop me at any time on these questions.
No, that's fine. I told you earlier, talk as long as you want
on
these.
It's up to you.
Let me ask you quick about the running. You say you run a lot.
I do. Well,
give me some numbers. And what are you talking about?
What do you mean?
Do you run a mile a day? Do you run 10 miles every week? I mean, how do you do that?
I mean, I do a lot more cardio now,
mm-hmm.
Only because I feel like that can be something that affects you in wrestling. Because if you think about, like, I don't think people understand all of the intricate things we have to do all at the same time while
mm-hmm.
we're in there. It's not just about going through the motions of whatever spot you're doing. It's not just about selling. Like, there's so many little things. You're talking facial expressions,
mm-hmm.
trying to have emotion on your face for whatever it is you're getting across in the match at that point. And at the same time, you're having to remember the spots that you're coming up to next,
mm-hmm.
right? And then you have to have the breath to remember to do all this. Because when you're tired,
mm-hmm.
and I'm sure both of you have been tired, especially if you did any kind of fighting stuff. I mean, that's like the most helpless feeling in the world, is being so tired you can't do anything.
Yeah.
And so with wrestling, if you're so tired, don't you think that's probably going to like start affecting your ability to sell?
Mm,
the show facial, because you're not thinking about that anymore. You're thinking about breathing.
Yeah,
right.
You know what I mean? So,
yeah.
In that respect, I just felt like cardio was something I needed to kind of concentrate on, and that way, I'm not worried about breathing. I'm worried about this, or you know, whatever it is.
Right. Yeah.
So, a lot of the times I was just doing a lot of HIIT cardio, some more high intensity stuff. I had like. Where I work, we actually got these heart rate monitors in, so I was using those as kind of a sense of motivation, because it would just pop up on my phone and tell me where I'm at, like if I'm in 90% of my heart rate or whatever. So I just tried to make sure I was working out in enough intensity.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I haven't used that in a little while, but I've just been trying to make sure I get stuff in because it's so hard now. So, like, I've ran twice this week, maybe. One of those was just a 20-minute deal, which is kind of low intensity, and then I did, like, a series of sprints, which are, like, 20-second sprints.
Right.
And then the other one was just I ran a mile, was just kind of see where I was at on the mile, and it wasn't even, like, full-out effort or anything, but it was, like, 9 minutes, and I was still good to go afterwards. I could breathe and talk just fine afterwards. So I probably, if I was to guesstimate, probably could run a mile in like under 7 minutes, maybe. Nothing crazy great,
yeah.
But you know.
Yeah, nothing to sneeze at either, though. Nate, we're about